This video is intended for educational purposes only. Its content is entirely educational in nature. We will be studying the history of the ideology known as antisemitism to understand its roots and development. We are not in any way intending to promote antisemitism. If the latter is what you are seeking, you will have to look for it elsewhere, or even better, to not look for it at all. Thank you. One sort of general concept that has to be laid out before we enter this is the reality that the history of antisemitism does not have to be sensical. It doesn't have to be logical. In other words, we can't tie these ideas of hate to actual events or phenomena in society. They're often entirely divorced. In fact, as the great philosopher Jean-Paul Sartre once put it in a very important book that he wrote right after World War II, Reflections on the Jewish Question, if the Jew did not exist, the anti-Semite would invent him. In other words, anti-Semitism is looking for some excuse to express itself. The reasons for this are complex and enter more the realm of psychology than of history. It's very similar in many ways structurally to misogyny, a similar kind of hatred in which, you know, people basically displace their dissatisfaction with their current status or the state of life onto a scapegoat. So for an example of this, we see one of the most notorious anti-Semitic works of the 19th century is the Protocols of the Learned Elders of Zion, which purported to describe the cabal of a Jewish conspiracy to, you know, dominate the world. And it was a forgery that was composed in the Russian Empire at the end of the 19th century. But it proved incredibly popular with all kinds of audiences, translated many, many times into multiple languages, and even, as you see here, even into Japanese, rather remarkably, given the very, very tiny presence of Jews in Japan overall. It's the spelling of the word anti-Semitism, and this is significant not only on a pedantic level, but more importantly on the way we approach anti-Semitism. The term itself is an invented term, a coined term that was designed by this man, Wilhelm Marr, who was himself an anti-Semite, and he wished to find a more polite alternative to the ruder terms Judenfeinde or Judenhass, which were kind of like rude terms. You wouldn't use that in proper political discourse. So he coined the term anti-Semitism in this book, The Way to the Victory of Germanness Over Jewishness. He wanted to say that essentially there was something called Semitism to which one could be anti. And so by using that term anti-Semitism, he was saying essentially, hey, I'm not anti-Jewish, I'm not racist, I'm not, prejudiced against any group of people. I am against this philosophy that happens to be expressed by this group of people. And of course, since this philosophy is nonsense, it certainly makes no sense to say one is anti-Semitism. So most scholars today prefer the term anti-Semitism as a single word because it refers to the phenomenon of hatred itself rather than displacing it onto some other fictional notion. Now, let us go to the actual history of the ideas. Looking at classical xenophobia, when we look at it closely, there is a significant number of nasty things said about Jews in much of Greco-Roman literature. But for the most part, speaking in generalities, it's the same kind of antipathy that the Greeks or the Romans had for non-Greek and non-Roman culture in general. And the kind of hostility that's expressed to Jews is often simply a reflection of their lack of understanding of who the Jews were and what they were all about. For example, because they observed one day of rest every 7 days, which was a novel thing in the ancient world, they were considered lazy. You know, how can they take off so much time from work? Because they would only eat kosher food, they were considered very clannish because they wouldn't, you know, go and participate in non-Jewish catered events. People, and all these things were simple misunderstandings of what Judaism is all about. But what we have to say about all of this is that classical xenophobia, as distasteful as it is essentially a kind of normal human hatred. In the very same way that neighboring cultures often misunderstand each other, even in the United States of America, there are lots of cultural tensions between ethnic groups. And that's just, you know, a normal feature of humans bumping up against each other's worldviews. To see one example of it, if you look at the Arch of Titus shown here in Rome, which was a magnificent structure that was erected to commemorate the defeat of the Jews in the first Roman-Jewish war in the first century, there is one particular section underneath the center of the arch on one side, which depicts the Jews carrying away the spoils from the temple to their Roman captors. And this is sometimes interpreted as an image related to anti-Semitism, but it's really just your pretty much run-of-the-mill war propaganda. It doesn't make the Jews look good, but it is not in any way a special bias against Jews that you wouldn't see them celebrating against any other people or barbarian tribe that they may have defeated. Here, by the way, is what it would have looked like in the original, because the Romans rather garishly painted their statues, and it was recently reconstructed with chemical analysis. And you can see they're carrying away the menorah. Very apropos, since we are now in the month of Kislev, coming up to the holiday of Hanukkah. At any rate, that's what we can say basically about classical xenophobia, is that it is a kind of a normal hatred that, you know, Jews were looked at negatively primarily because they were different than the dominant culture. On the other hand, when you come to Christian anti-Judaism, you have a very different kind of theological conflict, primarily because Christianity, which of course emerges in the first century, is an entirely Jewish phenomenon for the first century-odd activity of its existence. All of the early apostles were Jewish, and of course the founder was Jewish, and as they are separating and moving themselves away from the synagogue, and the synagogue is also taking steps to ostracize people with Christian beliefs from the synagogue, there's a level of antipathy built up. But it is almost entirely theological in nature. As you see, for example, expressed in Gothic art, here's a remarkable structure that showed a trope that we've seen hundreds of times throughout medieval art history, the Ecclesia et Synagoga. On the left is a representation of the church. She's got her boat is done up properly. She's wearing a crown. She's holding a staff that is unbroken, whereas she's contrasted with the synagogue that has no crown, is literally in a posture of decline, falling away from the rock. Her staff is broken, indicating she's lost authority, and from her left hand falls the Ten Commandments. She can't even hold on to her own faith, and she is, of course, blindfolded to the truth. And this was especially important for educating illiterate peasants about the theological underpinnings of Christianity and how it should be distinguished from the Jews who were still living among them in many of these villages and urban centers. Sometimes these images had a more violent tone, such as in this 15th century stained glass window from Werben, Germany, which shows, among other things, the hand descending from heaven to crown the church on the left, whereas on the right, representing synagoga with the same kind of images as in Strasbourg, there is a sword descending into the top of her head, a much more violent expression of disapproval. So that's much more the first millennium or so of the Common Era, in which there is a theological overlay. It's more of a debate between a priest and a rabbi, rather than, you know, between cultures bumping up against each other. By the time we get to the 13th century, but especially by the 15th century, things go completely pathological, and all kinds of new ideas are invented, such as this bizarre blood libel that Jews somehow need to, you know, capture Christian children and then reenact the crucifixion and then drink their blood in order for various ritual purposes. Absolutely absurd, with no basis in reality whatsoever. This evolves or devolves into images like the Judensau that depicts Jews. And by the way, these are all designated as Jews because they have the small circle on their cloaks, which was a part of the church regulation from 1215 onward, that Jews were supposed to have some kind of distinguishing feature like a badge on their cloaks. And even the devil here is shown wearing a Jewish badge, and they're involved in various disgusting activities with a pig. Again, no real theological content to this, and way beyond anything you see in the period of classical xenophobia, but that's characteristic of the medieval period. I should point out that, especially in this very brief presentation, I am placing things into large chronological blocks, but there's a certain degree of overlap, such as, for example, a painter in Italy reproduced in absolutely horrific detail, another example of the blood libel, even in our own times. Rather amazing how offensive this image could be, and yet it would be circulated in contemporary times. So that's basically taking us up until the modern period. In the modern period, there is a dramatic change that is largely the result of the thought of Joseph Arthur de Gobineau, Count de Gobineau, who started the notion of racism in a very famous essay on the inequality of human races. He articulated this notion, which borrowed heavily from Darwin in particular, that there are different qualities to divisions in humanity along racial terms. And this idea of race was actually quite new in the 19th century. Prior to that, we did have the sense of color bias, but the notion of a kind of a quasi-scientific distinction between peoples based on race was a huge innovation. And in terms of the various races, Africans were considered to be less intelligent, and the northern Aryans were considered to be much more punctual and noble and so on. The Jews were viewed as a kind of a parasite race, that their genius was their ability to find healthy societies, to infect them like vermin, and then, you know, degrade them from the inside and ultimately take over and then move on to the next host. As you see in this 20th century Austrian election poster, the Jew is portrayed as a kind of a worm choking to death the Austrian eagle, or here in a also 20th century German novel, Die Sünde wider das Blut, the sin against the blood, and then underneath says Ein Zeitroman, a novel of the times, which shows the Jew as a carrion-eating vulture that is somehow weighing down the healthy, muscular Aryan man, waiting for him to expire so he can pick on his bones. This is the image you'll note has, neither of these images have anything to do with theology, nothing to do with the cultures bumping up against each other and saying that the Jews are somehow different because we misunderstand them. This is a wholly invented ideology that nevertheless was extremely influential and, of course, resulted in one of the bloodiest centuries in history. Another element of the modern period, not necessarily associated with de Gobineau, but building on it, was the notion that these Jews, constituting a separate kind of vermin parasite race, are engaged in a conspiracy, that one of the skills of the Jews is that somehow they're able to join together around the world. So you see many examples, such as in this French example, which is late 19th century, that shows the Jews dominating the world, or in this Mexican publication of the Protocols of the Elders of Zion, which shows again the capitalist Jew with the traditional waistcoat and things like that, squeezing blood out of the earth. The caption reads, by the way, the invisible world government, right? Another way of saying the Jews, the Jewish program to subjugate the world. So this combination of racism and conspiracy is what especially is associated with the modern anti-Semitic trope. The Nazi strain essentially takes it to an extreme. Children's propaganda, like this book, Der Giftpilz, which is all about recognizing the difference between regular mushrooms and toadstools, which are poisonous, saying that, you know, Jews may look like regular people, but they are actually a separate race and they are quite dangerous and so on. Here's another example from some of these children's propaganda from the Nazi period, showing the distinctions between Jews and non-Jews, and Aryans in particular, and the notion of conspiracy. These are all tropes which were developed in the late 19th century, but the Nazis took to an extreme. Finally, to wrap it up and just think for a minute about how things might be changing in our times, we are now in a period where one of the most important ideas, at least in America, is this concept of the Great Replacement, that somehow the Jewish racial conspiracy that was first articulated in the 19th century is going to result in some kind of like taking over specifically of white male power in America that fuels a lot of the anti-Semitism on the right in particular. That's an extremely important phenomenon in America, and it goes right out of the 19th century. We also see some absolutely horrific anti-Semitic propaganda related to Israel, which sometimes comes from the left. Sometimes the criticism of Israel goes way past any of the normal boundaries of what we would expect as political conflict, such as this image, which evokes the blood libel. So with that, I've concluded my lightning tour of a very nasty part of Jewish history. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak, and I look very much to hearing what the panelists have to say about our times.